forward, I could take this boat that we built here up and enter the trials. I had to join the New York Yacht Club. That didn't cost a lot of money, other than the price of the boat. Anyhow, originally, if you may have seen, this is the Burgee of the New York Yacht Club. And of course, I had that Burgee on transom of the boat. I did have, along with it, the St. Petersburg Yacht Club, and I'm a member from since 60-something of the Cruising Club of America. I had both of those Burgees on there. Well, they asked me not to do that, so we had to modify it. But anyway, we've got something here about, it's a little tongue-in-cheek, but Morgan Stein, that's my old shipmate. Morgan and I sailed together with Dennis Connors in the Southern Circuit on a race or two, and I think Morgan was his press agent. I was his personal psychiatrist. Dennis, you know, he's such a...
The song is called The Day We Lost the America's Cup. It was written by a guy and sung by a guy by the name of Tom Paxson. And it's unusual. And let's see if we can get this thing running here.
Anyhow, it's a tongue-in-cheek thing. The New York Yacht Club makes such a to-do about whether you could even be in that great club to race for the America's Cup.
Whoops, sorry, guys.
Morgan's a writer, not a technician. I think he's he blows smoke pretty well. I think he had a radio station.
He wore the rays and coal black shades and a Billy Woodrow routine. Ben knew some new born surgeons about how to get into his pain. Australia won the America's Cup, we had too little too late. The little guy turned the lights on, neon bloodshot red and blue. He said we lost the America's Cup because we lose the saucer too. Tell you one thing more, I didn't know we had the cup. What the damn thing for? Sailing boats, you put me on, and Captain Andy hats. And they call that a bubba dub dub a race till I walk as fast as that. You say I'll spend you one cup, you tell me what it got. One thing you ain't told me, Jack, and who it is that lost. Yeah, who I was on, who lost the cup and I had to let it go. New York Yacht Club, if you say you tell me it ain't so. So the New York Yacht Club blew the tender flag and half-man flew. Jack, please excuse my lack of tears, but the son of cats on his way. They got half a big to life. They got blood and blue in the sky. And I hope that boy is someday there to kiss the cup goodbye. We had the club, how long is it? 132 years. And now Australians won the cup and filled it with bottled beer. And now the yacht club dark and gold, and now it's draped in black. I hope it takes them quite a long to get the damn thing back. Yeah, I feel for all the yacht club studs, this little guy I need. The side of that empty trophy case will be a heavy sight to see. It must be hell to lose the cup when you have it for so long. He took his saxophone out of his case. He played a sad little song. It went.
Sailors, but you know, when I went up to New York Yacht Club to sit with Harry Morgan, who I don't think is a relative, probably is way back when, but in the committee, and they wanted me to assure that there would be no corporate money backing up my boat, my campaign. Well, I didn't know it, but those devils were having a hell of a time raising for their own Commodore $950,000 that was the budget they had for it, and I think they ran over about twice before it was over. And here they were giving me some jazz about, you know, writing my own ticket for it. But, you know, I think we lost a lot when it is no longer a nation against nation or a national type of thing, and hired guns, professionals. I could only have one professional aboard my boat. I let him run the tender. He didn't sail with us. And it just is interesting how things change, and sometimes I think we lose by it. It's now, the last time I talked to Dennis, it was about a year ago, and he said, well, Charlie, I sailed my last America's Cup. He said, you know, I can't sail the boat and put the crew together and raise the money. So these billionaires can write a $150 million check, you know, and forget it. And it would be all I could do if I could raise that much. He says, and it takes more than that, really, to do it right. So anyway, that's where it's come to. But anyway, I want to go on now. I think we're here. Oh, here we go. All right, there's that fabulous shot. That's that shot I should. Okay. Well, here we are coming in off the American. I think we're probably approaching the finish line in one of the races. I'm not going to show you a lot of sailing activities, but boy, these boats are just great in that Atlantic Ocean out there. They just eat it up and spit it out. Got to warm down the wind. Those of you Florida fans out there, see the colors we carried. Somebody thought that that was ideal. Here's a very exciting start. That's Heritage right here. That's the Commodore of the New York Yacht Club in Valiant. That's Intrepid. This is the old lady with one of the slickest sailors there ever was, with George Hinman. And that's Weatherly. I beat Weatherly in that race, or in the race, the next race, and we sailed against her. And the newspaper said, Heritage beats up on old lady. That was all we could do it too. And this is the last race crossing the finish line. That's America's replica in the background. And going on to other things here. This is, I don't know when this shot was taken. It was after a day's sail, we were heading in. We all of us did a lot of training up there. And here's the flag. I had to take off the other two, which was my choice. But this boat was a real masterpiece of construction. The guys, we had our what we called our League of Nations, and they were so skilled and wonderful workers. And had, well, for me, it was a great experience because I didn't know enough to do that on my own. But boy, those fellows just jumped in. And it was a great experience for them at their later stages of life. They were all older than I. So I was saying that we were to come very close to losing the cup this year and an earlier year in 62 and even 64. The indications were that the other boats were faster than us and we had better sails. They very definitely had better sails, which obscured the fact that we were getting port information out of the test tanks. And that we were, these boats, I just say, Columbia and Weatherly came out at around 56,500 pounds approximately in 1958. And they were 45 and a half feet on the water, 45 feet, 3 inches on the water line. In 1970, we had pushed them out to roughly 50 feet on the water line, which meant we had to give up sail area and we had to carry a lot more weight, because the boat had to weigh much more per foot of length of waterline. And I forgot to take the trade-off there, but it was significant. And these boats were getting chunkier and less slim, and you're going to see that when I show you some lines. But this is Owen Stevens. Look how he looks young there for a 99-year-old fellow. He just turned 99 years old yesterday. Bless his darling heart. Great man. Wonderful. Anyhow, Britt Chance, who had modified Olin's Intrepid from 1967. They say, comparing whether we stand data to new Intrepid, she's showing up much better on the race course. Well, the message was, our new boats were slow, and very slow, and mine was too. And so, while in high winds, we would be maybe faster than the earlier boats, there was, and the maximum speed that could be attained under, you know, full press of sail, but by and large, they were slower boats. Okay, but I'm not going to be able to tell too much. I tried to get a better resolution of this for you, but this is Columbia, and what a lovely, sweet set of lines that is. That sweet little boat was just a joy to sail, as quick as she could be, and she was. That was only 56,500 pounds nominally. When I sailed on her in 62, we added 1,200, 1,400 pounds of ballast and got rid of some stuff so we could float on her original line. And, okay, here is Constellation, which is a gorgeous set of lines, the horse of a boat, as Owen said. She was heavier than about 46 and a half feet on the waterline. It probably tells over here. But again, a very handsome boat. But she had a hard time getting beating Bill Luter's American Eagle, which was smaller and a slightly different approach to things. This is the beginning of the stern modifications that wind tunnel test was showing. And here's the Scimitar rudder that we all tried out later on this year. And then here comes, this is,
Britain Chan?
Yeah, okay, Britain Chan, thank you. That is the modified Intrepid. But this is the kind of stern that he evolved out of those wind tunnel tests and the investigations that were going on in as the years progressed. This boat was 48 feet 9 inches on the waterline and therefore a lot heavier. Here's the lines for Heritage. She was 70,500 pounds, and Valiant, which I didn't include here, was sort of the same shape, weighed 72,500 pounds. And we were just going in the wrong direction. Now, as the season wore on in 70, we got notice from the test tank that they had recalibrated the dynamometer and found that it was out of tune. And we should be anticipating about a 1.5 to 2% increase in resistance in the upright condition over the higher range of wind velocity, or rather boat speeds. Well, we were seeing that. And as Owen Stevens once said to me, he said, well, Charlie boy, the starting place is to get very low uprights, in other words, low upright resistance, and then work out the correct keel to go along with it for windward work. Well, in 1969, I had talked to Halsey Herslof, who had sailed with us in Rage, the 67 Bermuda race. And we had talked about the idea of building a small boat because our investigations had shown that we could build a boat 2,000 pounds lighter from a structural standpoint. And maybe we should just build a small boat and use the lighter hull and more ballast to make it do in heavy weather. Well, guess what happened?